Well, welcome to this first lecture. If you haven't taken the time to look at the brief clip that goes through the syllabus, expectations, and outline of this course, go ahead and stop this and go back and watch that first, because I believe that will help you as you prepare for these 8 lectures that you'll be watching over the coming weeks. Now, it's hard to see where I'm standing, but this is the First Baptist Church in Krakow, Poland. This is where we live. We first attended this church back in 1991 when we came as language students. At that time, it was the only church, a city of nearly 800,000, a church with about 80 members. And so you see about 0.01%. So the task here is great. I'm taping this with my computer. Hopefully, it will cooperate as we go through the information here of the first lecture. And I'll begin with the question. It's really a basic question. What is the theme of the Bible? I mean, if someone were to ask you, okay, this book seems important to you, how would you sum it up in a word or a phrase or a sentence? And there are many different opinions, actually, some very strongly held. Several years ago now, Deborah Criswell, pastor of First Baptist Church of Dallas, at that time the largest Baptist church in the world, actually preached a very famous sermon, The Scarlet Thread of Redemption, which traced from Genesis 1 through Revelation this theme of redemption or salvation history, that is what the whole Bible was building up toward and the culmination was about. Similarly, Adrian Rogers, also a famous preacher of the previous century, he was at Bellevue there in Memphis, and he preached a similar sermon, The Red River of Redemption. Again, this being the central theme that developed throughout all the scripture. Well, more recently, you've probably heard of John Piper, and he has brought to the forefront over the last decade, maybe even 20 years, the glory of God as the central dynamic theme of the Holy Scriptures, that all points to the glory of our sovereign Creator in God. Others would say, no, actually, Jesus is the center of the Bible. Christ is that pivotal moment, his coming, everything leads to that, and then from that everything unfolds. And so that would be an argument. Christopher Wright recently wrote a book, The Mission of God. And his argument would be, no, actually, missions is the center of Scripture. In fact, he argues against the general practice in many of our seminaries and universities where we have the discussion of the biblical basis of missions, as if we need to come to the Bible to prove the authenticity and the needfulness, the priority of missions. He actually argues for a missional reading of the Bible. And that's not mere semantics. He even would argue that the Bible should be, or missions should be, our hermeneutical key or lens, as it were, as we read the Bible. So when we come to any passage of the Bible, it's hit with the backdrop that God's mission, the ultimate mission in which we join him, is the driving theme of all of Scripture. Again, which is accurate? Are they mutually exclusive? Well, I would argue that they're not. And so I come to this summation that may be wise for you to note, is that I believe that missions is at the center of the Bible. Redemption is at the center of missions. Christ is at the center of redemption, and all is for the glory of our God. And so I believe it's like concentric circles, or like a target that says, yes, this is where all of the flow from Genesis through Revelation leads us. And so this is, of course, the introduction to missions, or to missiology, the study of missions. And so we want to begin by looking at God's Word, that this isn't just a peripheral topic. Even sometimes I think we do damage as we organize our churches. It's interesting, especially in the States, the larger churches will have a children's department and a youth department, maybe a music pastor or leader, worship leader, maybe a discipleship department, a missions pastor, missions department, as if these were all side-by-side approaches or needs or simply good ministries to do. I believe we should look more like, if you look at a building, like prayer is the foundation upon which all is built. And missions is like the roof upon which all is done. And so it's missions among children, through children, with children, among youth, through youth, with youth. And so again, I believe we need to rethink that missions isn't just a good idea. It's not something that we ought to find time to do. It's not something that we should simply support financially by taking up an offering occasionally. But it should become the driving force of who we are as the people of God. And I don't say that simply because I'm a missionary that lives in Poland. I believe there's biblical warrant, and that's what I want to cover these few minutes that we have during this first lecture. When you come to Scripture, you could actually see the multiple missions that unfold throughout the Bible. In fact, in recent years, there's been an attempt, and I believe a wise one, to study or to bring to the forefront the meta-narrative or overarching narrative of the Bible. And some people say, well, why? Well, I see a very key reason. That there are many times, even as we share the gospel, or we share some truth from Scripture, or we make some argument even in the social realm, whether it's Facebook or others, and we try to speak against maybe evils, whether it's abortion or euthanasia or something else. And many times we don't know how to even handle the Word of God. And we bring out Scriptures, maybe out of context, and we try to apply them to somewhere. And the meta-narrative or the grand narrative of Scripture, I believe, keeps us honest to say this is the flow of the story, as it were. And there are four grand parts. There's creation. And it's very difficult to understand the gospel if we don't understand creation. Because if we don't understand that God was active in creating us, making us in His image, that is key to understanding why we seek Him. And it tells some of that as you go to Romans 1 and 2. But you have creation, and then the fall. That helps us understand why we're in the condition we are, individually, as families, societies, and ultimately as the world. And so the story continues, creation, fall, a redemption. That's the whole process by which God is bringing back to Himself, reconciling to Himself a fallen world. And then yet to come, the restoration, the new heaven and the new earth. And so when we speak of God's activity, when we speak of the mission of God, it's in the context of the story. So again, looking back in the Old Testament, how does that story unfold? What are the steps? What are the missions with the small m that develop? Well, the first mission we see humanity with a mission. Actually, the first command that was given to Adam and Eve in that first chapter, verse 28, when God said, multiply and subdue. Some people call this actually the cultural mandate. It was the first time man was told to cultivate, to develop, to express, and to expand that which God has given us. It wasn't simply to observe. It wasn't simply to rest, but it was to engage and use that creativeness that God gave to the original man and woman, but to each one of us. It was to multiply and subdue. They were told to give names to the animals, to the plants. And so there was an assignment. Again, it wasn't simply just to rest and relax, but work was a part of the ideal of the garden. And so humanity with the mission. You fast forward 11 chapters, chapter 12, you see Israel with the mission. Abraham is called. And it is said he will be blessed, but the key there is so that he can be a blessing. So the nations that come through him will be a blessing. And so again, you see the missional seed, as it were, developing early as the 12th chapter, expressly given Israel with the mission. We'll turn into the New Testament, Jesus with the mission. Clearly, he came to seek and to save that which was lost. He came to reconcile the world. And so Jesus came with a clear mission. It was consistent with that which had been unfolding from Abraham through the patriarchs, through the prophets. And then the church with the mission. Jesus' final words recorded in different ways there, where he says in Matthew's version, go therefore into all the world and make disciples, which is a command, of all nations. Again, harking back to Genesis 12, where their Abraham's seed will be a blessing to all nations. The church is to go make disciples of all nations. How are they to do that? Baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe or to obey all that I've commanded you. And Lord, I'm with you always, even to the end of the age. And so the church with the mission. And the mission of the church is not separate from those that went before. The mission of Christ, the Abrahamic mission, and even the mission all the way back to the garden itself. We need to understand that missions is not our work. It is not the sense of we feel guilty or we feel bad because some still haven't heard, but it's the fulfillment of God's work. And God is working through his church. That is his design. Sometimes you look at it and you can question that. Why would he choose such a weak vessel as us? Yet in his divine wisdom, he so ordained. According to scripture, there's no plan B. There's no angelic mission force that's waiting to swoop in if we, quote, drop the ball. And so the mission of the church is the continuation of that which has gone before us these thousands of years. There is actually another way to frame this. And again, I'm going fairly quickly because we could spend literally hours. But you can also look at the progressive covenants that come from the Old Testament and into the New. Some would even refer to the covenant of that cultural mandate to multiply and subdue. But the first covenant language we actually see in chapter 9, there's a covenant with Noah after the flood, after the water begins to recede there on Mount Ararat. And interestingly, chapter 9, verse 1, harkens back to Genesis 1:28, when again, it's a creational covenant to multiply again. And then you go to verse 9 of that same chapter, and you have the covenant of protection, the giving of the rainbow as a sign that God would not destroy the world again through floods. And so again, we see that covenantal agreement which points toward the one who's to come. Well, there was a covenant with Noah. Abraham, we've already referred to. Abraham in chapter 12 is given that covenant relationship. Many times people see Genesis 12 as a reversal of Genesis 11. If you look back in Genesis 11, you have that rebellious act where man tried to come together and, quote, build a tower to bring God down, the Tower of Babel. And God confused the languages and actually began the ethnic process of building nations. So we see the spreading of the nations in Genesis 11. In Genesis 12, we see the blessing of the nations, which we'll see ultimately in its culmination in Revelation with the bringing back of all of the nations. And so that threefold covenant with Abraham, it's easy to remember if you can think of people, place, and purpose. The people of God. God is going to build a case study by calling out Israel. It wasn't that Israel was special in and of themselves. It wasn't that God looked at them and thought there was something unique about them. Just as it is not that he has called us to missions or any of the body of Christ because he looked at us with great eyes of potential, but simply because of his grace. And so he set aside Israel so that the world could see what a nation led by God would look like. So you see a people of God. You see the place of God, the promised land, that God was going to design there at that crossroads of ancient history, a people which would have a place, the promised land. And again, we know that Jesus is going to come back, it says there, to the Mount of Olives. And then a purpose, that of through his seed, singularly, of course we know that to be our Lord Jesus, there's the purpose of redemption and reconciliation. And so the covenant with Abraham. Fast forward a bit. The covenant with Moses found many places, but Exodus chapter 19, verses 1 through 9. You see the giving of the law, often summed up in the Ten Commandments, but far greater than that. The law, which was a covenant, again, Paul would write to be as a tutor to prepare us for the coming of the Messiah. And so this covenant was temporary in the sense it was that preparatory for the one who is to come and fulfill that law. the covenant with David would be the following covenant, where he would not lack for a descendant upon the throne. And of course, we know that Jesus is called the Son of David. He comes through the Davidic line. And of course, he is that eternal king who will reign forever and ever. And then we come to the prophets, Jeremiah chapter 31. He writes of a covenant yet to come. Chapter 31, verse 31 is worth reading. But Jeremiah writes, "Behold, days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Not like the covenant which I made with their fathers in the day I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. My covenant which they broke, although I was a husband to them, declares the Lord. But this is the covenant which I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my law within them, and on their heart I will write it. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people. They will not teach again each man his neighbor and each man his brother, saying, Know the Lord, for they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and their sin, I will remember no more. And again, a new covenant I will give. And what does that mean? Well, do you remember the night before the crucifixion when Jesus took the bread and broke and he took the cup? And when he raised the cup, he said, This is my blood, the blood of the new covenant. That is the fulfillment of all the covenants that were preparatory, that this enters into a new stage of salvation history, a new time of the ability for man to repent and respond to that which the Lord sacrificed upon the cross and through the resurrection overcame death. Well, that was quickly through the Old Testament. Well, when you come to the New Testament, some people believe, okay, missions, that began at Pentecost, but not really. Again, it's the Old Testament that sets the stage over and over, building up to the climax. And even in the Gospels, we see, for example, in Matthew, we see the charter of the church, where Jesus says there at Caesarea Philippi, when he asks, who do people say that I am? And the apostles, they say, well, some say you're Elijah, some Jeremiah, some one of the prophets. Then he says, who do you say that I am? And Peter, speaking for the others, say, Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And interestingly, what Jesus says there is flesh and blood didn't reveal you to this. What he's saying is, Peter, it's not that you finally had an aha moment from all my teaching with you. This was spiritually given to you. And as a worker overseas, I come back to that often, because anytime someone comes to faith, it is a spiritual conviction that comes upon them. And then Jesus gives the charter of the church. He says, upon this rock, upon this confession, I will build my church. And so we see that in Matthew, that Jesus is speaking of a new type of the people of God, not through heredity, not through blood, but through faith, in the sense of not through relationship, but through the one who comes by faith and spiritually through relationship of the new birth and is adopted by the king. So Matthew, we see the charter of the church. We see ministry to Gentiles more in that gospel than the others. We also see the Great Commission at the end, the greatest summation when Jesus says, go into all the world and make disciples of every nation. Mark, the shortest gospel. And then some see the commission in the final part of the last chapter as a disputed passage, whether it was added later or not. One of the more telling times is when Jesus cleanses the temple, according to Mark's account. When he quotes from the Old Testament, he says about the temple, my house shall be a house of prayer for all the nations. Again, this wasn't an exclusive place of prayer, but it was for the Gentiles as well. And so we see that in Mark's gospel. Luke, we see a profound importance. Even in the infant narratives, that which we read every year or watch Linus as he quotes in Charlie Brown and the Peanuts, when the angels appear to the shepherds, fear not, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be for all peoples. Again, this Messiah, this baby, this king who is born, And the Magi will come from far to bring him gifts. But he is not just for Israel. He's also for the Magi. He's for the world. He'll be for all peoples. Unto you is born this day a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. So Luke even begins with the good news. Chapter 10 of Luke, we see Jesus sends out the 70, sometimes called the 72, as they go into the villages. And their first word of greeting is peace. Peace be to you. And Jesus says, if that peace comes back, then reside there and tell them the good news of the kingdom. Preach to them. And so we see, as it were, a precursor. How do we, as the church, which was just about to be developed, go and take the message? And I think in Luke 10, Jesus gives us just an example of how to do that. And then, of course, at the end of Luke, we also read a commission where we're to go into all the world and preach the gospel. John's gospel is unique of the four, and we see mostly there the unfolding mission of the Lord Jesus as he writes this probably toward the end of that first century. And then, of course, Acts. We come to Acts 1:8. Some even see as a table of contents when Jesus says, and you'll receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the earth. And so again, we see, as it were, a preview. How is the gospel going to spread? There at Pentecost in chapter 2 in Jerusalem, there are people from all over the world who have come for the festival there. And as the gospel spreads, 3,000 come to faith. And it begins to emanate through Judea, Samaria, and beyond. We need to understand Samaria, not just geographically, because also Samaritans were half Jews. They were a mixed group, and therefore they were generally hated by the Jewish people. That's why the parable of the Good Samaritan had such power, and the narrative of the Samaritan woman at the well in John chapter 4 carried so much weight. And so we see the geographical expansion, but also we need to see the social ramifications, that it was to cross barriers, Jew to proselyte, to God-fearer. Then ultimately we see Cornelius to Gentiles. And that's Paul's whole story as Luke writes Acts, as it unfolds the missionary journeys, as Paul is taking this gospel with his co-workers into all the world. So we see missions history unfolding. And again, even the epistles. A lot of times people want to separate the epistles from the context of that day. The epistles were missionary letters. Paul wrote most of them. And the settings are generally writing those new churches that have been started to say, okay, I need to follow up because you're struggling with this. This is how you appoint elders. These are qualifications. This is how you deal with sin. This is how you deal with immorality there in the church of Corinth. This is what love actually looks like. And on and on. And we ought to look at these through the lens of young congregations learning what it means to follow Christ. The Bible hasn't been put together yet, and so they're getting parts of it from here and here, and they're reading in different churches the different parts that they have. And Paul's writing to say, this is how the mission should look where you gather together as the local body of Christ. And so that's what the epistles really are for. And then Revelation, of course, gives that final throne room scene, chapter 7. Just amazing passage when John is writing, gets to verse 9, he says, and after these things, I looked and behold a multitude, which no one could count, from every nation, all tribes, peoples, and tongues, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. He goes on to say, clothed in white robes, and palm branches are in their hands, and they cry out with a loud voice, salvation to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. And then they're joined, all the angels were standing around the throne, and the elders, and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. And that's the culmination. That's where this is headed. That's the flow of missions history. That's the flow of salvation history. That's where the meta-narrative goes ultimately to final restoration. So that's what the Bible is about. And so when we speak about missions through these coming lectures, it's not a department of a church. It is not a portion of Scripture. It is the heartbeat of Scripture. And so when we talk about historical ramifications and practices, we talk about strategic applications. It flows from not just the Word of God, but from the heart of God. There have been many times in history where there had been mission opportunities, doors that opened, and the church missed them. 13th century Kublai Khan purportedly invited Christian missionaries to his court, and yet it took decades. By the time they got there, his greeting was, "It's too late. My people have already embraced ancestral worship and beyond." Think of the opportunity that was there. The end of World War II, Douglas MacArthur, a general, said, "We need to send thousands of missionaries to Japan. It's broken and they're open." And yet only a few trickled in. In my lifetime, 1989, the Berlin Wall came down. Communism began to fall across 12 time zones. And yet we didn't fully seize the opportunity that was there. In a decade, when people look back to 2015, 16, 17, and say, all those refugees fled North Africa, Middle East, and Central Asia, and they went into the western part of the continent. And they, many of them were so open, and just kind of on the side here, many have come to faith, but have we fully embraced the opportunity that is ours? Have we fulfilled as a church the missionary call to all the nations? Well, I hope that you've already begun to read in your textbook. And for the assignment for this first week of class, it would be the first four chapters from Introduction to Global Missions. And actually, the third chapter is entitled The Missiological Basis of the Bible. In chapter 4, page 83, there's a question I want you to ponder and respond to. Does everyone have to hear and believe the gospel to be saved? What about the native on South Sea Island? What about someone who's never heard? What about an Eskimo up in the North Pole? Do they have to hear the gospel? Do they have to respond to the gospel to be saved? And I want to hear your thoughts. I want that to be one of our discussions over the next week. And then the second aspect or topic for week one is I want you to name and describe clear missional teaching symbols and expectations from the Old Testament. Again, I must have a good foundation when we talk about missions. Missions biblically, missions historically, missions strategically, that is grounded in the full counsel of the Word of God. Not simply on a couple New Testament passages that are our favorite, but there's a bedrock of where God began, where God is leading, and where this will end. Again, I enjoy the opportunity to share these truths from God's Word. I look forward to our interaction in coming weeks. I am at your disposal. Sometimes I travel, but I'm always available through email or as we interact on the internet site. And so welcome to the course, and I pray God's greatest blessings upon you over these coming weeks.